What up? It's your boy T-Bear and Reaction. Today is Films Friday, and today is time for the main course of Dead Me of main course of Films Friday, which is the Dead Me Kill Count. And next week is the Redemption Poll. So we are about this. Redemption polls are five kill counts that was the lowest of their four. Well, mainly four kill counts that was lowest in the polls, and one that was a previous lowest that was the lowest in the last redemption poll. So that being said, we have the remaining redemption poll: Shadow Rimmer, Mayhem, and Come to Daddy. It was joined by Come to Daddy, Hush, Scary Stories Tell in the Dark, and the most recent entry, Slither. Now, with the landslide victory of 50%, the one that was added last, Slithers, has earned a spot to get reacted to today, while the following: Scary Stories Told in the Dark, Come to Daddy will be evacuated from the Shadow Realm, and once for the first time ever remains in the Shadow Realm. The Redemption Poll Shadow Realm back to back is one movie that has Mayhem. First time in any of them, because most of the time movies be able to be escape the are able to escape the Redemption Poll, but this time we have one that is stuck in there for another while. That is Mayhem. And it's the sad thing about it, I think one of y'all was hoping Mayhem make it out of it, but I do apologize. And the person I gotta apologize to is Eva Ashman. Sorry about that. So then that, let's get into Slithers. I remember hearing about this movie, how crazy this was. Oh man. I know it's like a comedy horror in a way, but it's crazy and sadistic in a way. But not sadistic, it's crazy and wow. But I've always been curious of this movie, so this will be a good kill count to react to. So this came out 2006, so without further ado, let's check it out.
Welcome to the Kill Count, where
we're back with Zoran
and all our favorite horror movies. I'm Zoran's slightly different Flannel Gavoyich, and today we're looking at a slightly different kind of killer worm movie with Slither, released in 2006. Slither is James Gunn's directorial debut.
Yep, James Gunn's directorial debut, but he said that because we're not exactly finished yet, but we came off with the Tremors, which I will be finished that off. Well, I'll be finished off that series next week as well too. Next week.
After having written several movies directed by other people, and, you know, whatever Zack Snyder is. Mm-hmm. He intended to do the same with the Slither screenplay so he could make a little money and make his independent film super. But a bidding war commenced, and producer Paul Brooks at Golden Circle Films convinced him to direct the film himself.
I have a few laughs and, you know, realize that, fuck, this ain't a bad way to be earning a living.
Gunn got his start working for Trome Entertainment with his first film, Tromeo and Juliet.
Wow.
And this man is a true horror lover. He even says that Slither was inspired by his love of Cronenberg, Carpenter, the horror manga comic Uzumaki, and the schlocky monster movies of the 1980s. But not the 1986 Fred Dekker movie, Night of the Creeps, which many say Gunn ripped off, but he says he's never seen it, and he's missing out. Seriously, I don't know what that is, but I love it. Much like my music video social media Asicus, Slither is crammed with hidden horror Easter eggs, from the stores to the shot compositions to the character names. I'll point out some of my favorites, but it would take a full video to cover them all. And I don't have the best track record when it comes to releasing timely Easter egg videos. Slither is the story of a small town invaded by an outer space entity. It infects a local man named Grant, exacerbating marital issues between him and his wife Starla.
The center of Slither is really the story about the dissolution of a marriage.
As their marriage falls apart, so does the town, as Grant impregnates, assimilates, and occasionally eviscerates everyone around him. The only man who can stop him is Sheriff Bill Pardee, played by the true live-action Nathan Drake, Nathan Fillion. But who is Bill Pardee?
I'm Bill Pardee.
He's Bill Pardee.
You're Bill Pardee,
he's right, though.
That's in addition to Fillion and this completely stacked cast, the movie also boasts a ton of incredible practical effects, done by Todd Masters and his team at Masters Effects. So many, in fact, that Slither single-handedly depleted the nation's supply of silicone, and it took over a month for the manufacturing...
And the fun fact, Michael... Oh, what's his name again? The, Michael Rooker. You know, fun fact, Michael Rooker was part of another James Gunn movie later on. I think that's I think he did Guardian Galaxy though too, where he played I can't think of that name right now. Fuck it. Y'all I know the character name, but I can't think of it right now. It pissed me off a little bit in a way. Give me a second. Another fucker's name. Yondu. Yes. There we go.
To formulate more. And with that amount of fake flesh on deck, I'm gonna need a sponsor. So let me, Nathan, fill you in on Manscaped. This month, Manscaped has a special reminder for our audience. Are you listening? Come in a bit closer. No, genuinely, because Manscaped is partnering with the Testicular Cancer Society to remind ball possessors everywhere that you don't need to just shave your balls, you need to save your balls.
Yeah.
Testicular cancer is serious. So serious, in fact, that I'll be sacrificing my precious flannel here for a moment.
Flannel away!
Well, that feels weird, but necessary. Because every hour, someone is diagnosed with testicular cancer, and for Jewel Jostlers age 15 to 35, it's the most common form. But with proper monthly at-home checks, you can make sure that your little buddies don't ever end up looking like this.
It looks like something that fell off my dick during the war.
And if you want an added reminder, you can pick up the Manscaped Limited Edition TCS Lawnmower 4.0. Or, you know, you could just pick it up because it's purple, and that'll help you shave your purple mane. Purple mane. Oh God, it's on. Listen.
Yo, shout out to Zora, man. He's been killing it for a while James and Chelsea been away. But they are back though. And speaking of that, I talked it up. I think last week I said that on Otis's Texas Chainsaw Massacre. They do 2020. Lo and behold, that's the newest kill cut they released. So yeah, so you definitely won't see that in the poll probably soon. And possibly I might even bypass that, but we'll see. Might give it a bypass on that one. Who knows? But anyway.
I know that we're still selling you something here, but Manscaped is putting their money where their mouth is too by donating $50,000 to the Testicular Cancer Society. And that's something that we can all go nuts for. You can learn more about testicular cancer and get 20% off Manscaped by going to manscaped.com/TCS and using promo code TCSDeadMeat. How many more people will be murdered by this Slytherin house? Let's find out and get to the kills. The movie begins
in space
as a meteorite hurtles towards the town of Wheelsy, South Carolina. It quietly lands in the woods where Sam Raimi is frantically trying to find the Evil Dead set. No luck,
really?
But he does find a
title card.
Sound a little bit like a pirate when I say that. The next day, the town is filled with folks and Easter eggs as they prepare for the Deer Cheer Festival at Hennenlotter's Saddle Lounge. And that's a reference to Frank Hennenlotter, director of James A. Janisse's favorite basket boy.
Wow.
Max Wren's store is a reference to James Woods' character in Videodrome. Mm. And there's also R.J. McCready's funeral home, named after Kurt Russell's character in The Thing, because, you know, he was pretty good at cremating bodies. That surname also belongs to Mayor Jack McCready, who gets his first name from Jack Burton in Big Trouble in Little China. And it seems like he's having some trouble of his own here.
Get the fuck out of the way, cocksucker!
Morning, Mayor.
McCready is played by Greg Henry, a delightful character actor that's been in many other James Gunn films, and also one of the worst movies ever made, Ballistic, X vs. Sever. What a stupid name. Meanwhile, at the best named school in the world, Starla Grant teaches kids how to make a goddamn plan!
Sorry, I looked at the congratulation part. What was the school name? Urbasset. Nice.
While at the best named school in the world, Starla Grant teaches kids how to make a goddamn plan. She's played by Elizabeth Banks, who we've seen as the Martha to a shitty little Superman in Brightburn. After class, she sneaks in a quick cameo from director James Gunn.
Nice. I made this movie.
Before getting pulled away by her husband, Grant Grant. God damn it, I love that stupid name. Grant is played by Michael Rooker, an incredible actor who we previously saw getting domed with a wrench in the Belko experiment. Slither was the first time Gunn and Rooker worked together, and Gunn became a huge fan.
I remember he came in and I bowed down to to him. This is before I knew him, of course. If you get to know him, he's definitely not worthy of bowing down to.
This led to a real life friendship and continued collaboration in Gunn's later projects.
Yep.
I'm very popping, y'all.
Speaking of Guardians, Slither is the closest you're ever gonna get to an MCU movie on the kill count, since the worm parasites from Slither were featured in the collector's museum.
Oh,
but hey,
shit!
What the fuck isn't in the MCU at this point? Grant and Starlet have been married since she was 17, which is legal in South Carolina, but their love is faded, and she says she's not in the mood, sending Yondu and his blue balls to the local watering hole. He's approached by Brenda, the younger sister of one of his high school girlfriends, who's had a crush on him since she was young.
You couldn't have been more than 10 or 11.
Hell, that was game.
Oh boy, let's get away from these jokes before Disney fires us, okay? Mm-hmm. A drunken woods walk reveals Brenda's tragic initials.
BM! Like a piece of shit.
Oh, shut up.
And though fecal wordplay may be shitty foreplay, Brenda grants Grant a kiss. Grant stops things when he remembers he's married to Elizabeth freaking Banks.
Thanks.
Then follows a slime trail to a brain bug-like creature who's very happy to see him. This anatomically correct lemon dot is from that meteorite earlier, and it fills its super meter to perform an X-ray attack on Grant. Oh boy, taking over a human host sure can work up an appetite, but with no chocolate-covered pretzels in sight, Dr. Alien Grant heads back home for some
meat.
Ah yes, specifically Brundle brand meat, referencing Jeff Goldblum's character Seth Brundle from
The Fly.
The Fly. The next morning, Elizabeth Banks is sad more people didn't like her Charlie's Angels reboot.
Oh,
and
shit.
Decides to reboot her marriage with a pitch-perfect sexy dance set to Air Supplies, You're Every Woman in the World to Me. The alien inside Grant experiences love for the first time ever. Not only emotionally, but physically too, as Grant and Starla make a porno. The next day, Grant grabs some post-coitus
meat
and puts a lock on the basement door.
What's this lock doing on the door?
Oh, Starla, what is your obsession with my forbidden basement of mystery? Starla gives up her hotbox interrogation, and Marianne cranes her way into the shower with some really well-placed window fog. Grant and his tummy tentacles would love to reenact some scenes from La Blue Girl, but he doesn't want to get this video age-restricted, so he runs off with a flimsy excuse that leaves him sounding like an underpants gnome.
I gotta go to work!
Work on that, search for underpants, ho! That leaves Starla going to the Dear Cheer celebration unescorted, which is just fine with Sheriff Bill Party, who's basically been in love with her since they were teenagers.
Wow.
I'm surprised you're able to lift a mug you've been carrying that torch for so long.
That reminds me of something I want to tell you.
Sam,
fuck you, fat ass.
Bill tries to be more than just a Starla gazer and act on this certain unspoken thing between them. But he gets interrupted by a scene of Grant visiting Brenda. A fun countdown at Deer Cheer is intercut with the reveal of Grant's chesticles that he uses to impregnate Brenda. The tentacles were a combination of practical pieces by Masters Effects and digital tentacles created by visual effects supervisor John Gadeski. They're combined in a seamless blend that the two teams worked very hard to achieve.
Wow.
If you're smart and you can figure out how to key them together like that, you get something that people don't even know what they're looking at.
That night, Starla comes home to find Grant looking a little worse for wear.
It's just the bee stink.
Yeah, it's just an allergic reaction. His doctor said so. You can call him yourself.
I haven't seen your husband in over a year.
Well, Grant's a liar, but his doctor ain't. And that doctor is voiced by Rob Zombie, who also
cameos
in a couple of Gunn's other movies.
When I first met Sarah, I heard the words of God.
Oh, shit.
Marry her.
Listen, if James Gunn likes working with you, you're gonna work.
Yep.
Carla's suspicions for her husband deepen when she's visited by Bill and Wally. They tell her Brenda's missing and they think Grant is involved. So give Bill a call if Grant comes home or, you know, they want to do another Firefly movie. They leave and our little Betty Brant wants to get to the bottom of this story. So she breaks into their basement to find a lot of nicely categorized dead animals. Grant has turned this basement into an alpha-proof butcher shop. Phantom, look away!
Here we go.
Grant. Well, he's delivering a post-mortem mate's order to Brenda. Because just like him, she's hungry for that sweet, sweet Brundle meat.
Ah, yes. Hi, I'm Seth Brundle, owner of Brundle Farms. And if you're a scientist like me, then you're obsessed with improving upon nature's design.
Hold on a second while we go back to... I'm going to get to that. Something's up. Hold on a second. I'm back. Something's going on outside my house. It's not near us. Thank God. Not near us. Thank God. I got my ring going. So I'm going to probably be looking into my ring here and there to make sure everything's fine. Nothing goes on, but anyway, let's keep going.
Well, he's delivering a post-mortem mate's order to Brenda, because just like him, she's hungry for that sweet, sweet Brundle meat.
Ah, yes, hi, I'm Seth Brundle, owner of Brundle Farms, and if you're a scientist like me, then you're obsessed with improving upon nature's design. That's why our meat is a combination of all the animal food groups, chicken, beef, pork, and flies. Ah, wait a minute,
Lore.
Plus, our patented and completely infallible teleportation system will deliver your meat so fresh that you might have to kill it all over again. Don't. Brundle Lore. Farms. Be afraid. Be very afraid. Mm-mm. Of the savings. Starla calls the cops right as Grant returns. And since he sees this as a betrayal, he unmurls his dicks on her. But hey, she's already JD's baby mama. So she knocks Grant down to avoid getting knocked up. The rookie arrives with his squad, but Grant gets away while showing them just how snake-like he can be. In another CGI and practical effect blend, that actually dislocated Michael Rooker's arm on set. The next day, James Caan joins Peter Boyle on a cross-country road trip to find a stash of stolen money that...
Oh, man. By the way, R.P. James Caan, we sadly lost this past week as well, too. Perfect. So that was perfect timing. They showed this. I reacted to this, though. We sadly lost James Caan this past yesterday, I think. All right, so R.P. to him.
Okay, wait a minute. God damn it, this is the 1973 buddy road trip comedy, Slither. Okay, who cut this in here? Was it you, Josh?
Hey, what can I say? James Caan is sexy.
Okay, I mean, I can't argue with you there.
All right. Wow.
I love you.
Once again, R.I.P. James Caan. Perfect timing for me, I guess.
The 2006 Slither, it's 3 days later, according to the ugliest font imaginable. And they still haven't found Grant. They did, however, find this sad drunk, played by Lloyd Kaufman, co-founder of Troma Entertainment, where James Gunn got his start. In fact, earlier in the movie, Troma's Toxic Avenger can also be seen on the
TV.
And our lord and kill counter, James A. Janisse, told me to tell you that he'll cover the Toxic Avenger when the Peter Dinklage remake comes out.
Ooh.
Do you think he's going to cover the three sequels, or he's going to leave them behind like he did with the Hellraiser series? Am I right?
Oh, shit.
Please don't fire me. After Bill gets rid of his lunch of number 42 octopus and black bean sauce, he learns there's been another animal attack thanks to police dispatcher Shelby, played by The Office's Jenna Fisher, who was at the time married to James Gunn. That's fun. The latest attack was at the Castevets farm, a reference to the antagonist from Rosemary's Baby. Bill then gathers his team for even more references, starting with
Raglan's Ranch,
a reference to Hal Raglan from The Brood. And another animal was taken from Fitzgibbon's place, a reference to an actor in Cronenberg's Rabbit. And Bennell Park up here references Dr. Miles Bennell from the original Invasion of the Body Snatchers. And if that weren't enough, the whole police force has names of famous horror directors. Wally Whale is for James Whale, director of Frankenstein. Trevor Carpenter is John Carpenter.
John Carpenter.
Robert Hooper is for Toby, the director of Texas Chainsaw. And Deputy Tounard is Jacques Tounard, maker of Cat People and I Walk with a Zombie. But if they're all references, then who is Bill Pardee?
And don't forget.
Ha ha fucking ha.
5 seconds go by before another reference hits us with the Predator theme.
All right, boys.
And they head to a stakeout with enough guns to take down a goddamn sexual Tyrannosaurus. Starla shows up after changing wigs and convinces Bill that these two guys need a girl to find her pizza face of a husband. Bill and his ODST troopers wait around till nightfall with not a Grant in sight. So Bill kills some time flirting with the disembodied head of Starla.
Elizabeth Banks is a floating head in the shadow that still drives me crazy.
But before she can say, Mechaleka hi, Mechahiney, no I'm not interested, an amazing practical puppet of Grant's newest Pokemon evolution shows
Lore.
Up, spurring a very Ray Stantz-like reaction from MacReady. Can't tell if he's looking at Grant or Slimer. The on-set puppeteers in black suits are erased to give us a cow kill that looked much funnier when shot on its
own. Oh, shit. Lore. The way
fed up
fell.
With her husband's Hunger Games, Starla chases after him, and we finally get to see Granty, portrait of a head caterpillar. Rooker's makeup took over 3 hours to put on and 2 to take off, and the mechanical device on his neck that housed the motors for the head tentacles was very unpleasant.
Well, that machinery was tearing up his neck, to which he still has back problems because of that day. The kind of pain the guy put up with was incredible.
But pain is fleeting, and this iconic monster is forever. Oh, just like marriage.
For better or worse.
Much fucking worse.
Starla's appeal to their matrimony falls on deaf tentacles. And instead, Grant attacks this Charlie guy who threatens him. A tentacle whip.
Whoopah!
Gives the guy a sagittal bifurcation, accomplished with another perfect digital.
Fuse
blinks so much. He's the scene of the crime, and everyone chases him back to a super smelly barn. Ooh, maybe there's a graboid inside. Probably not. But the order of entry is determined by another
rock, paper, scissors.
Inside, they discover Brenda, having stolen some very experimental chewing gum.
Oh, shit.
What's wrong with me?
Lord.
What is all over her face?
It's just barbecue sauce.
Oh, cool. Yeah, I'm not making out with her. The Brenda blob was an effect that Gunn was very particular about.
They kept giving me designs of Brenda Blobs, and I kept drawing her. And I'm like, no, she's like this. She's like a big, you know, boob with her head as a nipple.
And that's exactly what he got. The 9-foot-tall Brenda monster was so large it had to be constructed in an airplane hangar. It was built over a lightweight spring steel frame, which helped her lunge and jiggle without the use of special equipment. Lead puppeteer Nicholas Podbray used puppet controls for her hands reaching for things, air pressure tubes to simulate wriggling worms inside her, and a big old ballet bar for lunging. Actress Brenda James had only read her first scene when she was cast, and didn't read the whole script until she was already on her way to a makeup test.
Lo and behold, I found myself sobbing in the air uncontrollably the whole way down to Los Angeles.
But Gunn was extremely kind to her on set and made sure she was taken care of.
Okay, let me get comfortable.
I will say this scene has some amazing comedic moments.
One handed me a piece of that possum over there.
But no one's laughing when they realize that Grant led them to this barn as a trap. Oh, Mr. Grant! And before they can do anything about it, the big round Brenda Blob bursts, spilling slugs into the straw. Man, home birds sure can get messy. The worms start to climb inside the deputy's mouths as Bill takes on a new job as COVID safety officer. The can of worms screensaver covers the cast before waking the movie back up and sending them off to the nearby Strutmeyer house. The worms approach the house with all the stealth of an alley of clowns. But Kylie Strutmeyer doesn't hear them as she relaxes with a bath. A sneaky Slurms McKenzie is ready to party with this babe, so it makes its way into the tub. We then get some shots mimicking Cronenberg Shivers and A Nightmare on Elm Street before Kylie is attacked. The practical worms used for this scene were made out of thermal gel, a strong elastic material developed for sex toys. Oh man, do you really want to taste that? Guess not. Kylie's fancy Pokemon nails keep the parasite from fully taking her over, but we do see flashes of it taking over another planet full of ROUSs. She eventually chucks the worm across the room, but this incredible Mr. Limper doesn't go down until being melted with a curling iron. Mm. Look away, Judy. Kylie checks on her family to find them all infected with worms.
Oh, shit.
Do not learn from Fry, don't eat truck stop egg sandwiches. Even her younger sisters are convulsing the walls are pulsing with worms. In a very cool shot that reminds me of arachnophobia.
Wow.
By the way, if you couldn't tell by now, we're only counting deaths when a body is killed, not when they get infected. James's orders. Kylie makes her way outside and into the family truck, which the worms swarm. And another great practical effect. You see, a black and white animation of the worms was projected onto the car to give the impression of them covering it completely. Mm. And it saved on CGI costs. Bonus! Back at the barn, we've got ourselves a whole mess of bodies, but none for me to count just yet.
They alive?
Brilliant.
Verified! Bill heads to town to radio for help while Starla and the rest gather up their friends. Wally returns to apparent life, now infected and a third-party conduit for Grant's apology.
I didn't mean to do none of them things I've done. Not make Brenda worm.
Well, looks like Grant's consciousness extends to everyone infected with wormy worms.
I'm your husband!
So put that goddamn gun down!
But when Deputy Hooper brings her gun up, she's sprayed with acid vomit and swells up like Weird Al in that music video. Oh, and she also dies too. Wally Grant gets pissed and yells at Starla, prompting her to blow his slug brain
out.
Another great practical effect. Goodbye, Rawl. Out of bullets, they take off into the woods. Bill finds the Strutmeyer family going after Kylie and distracts them long enough for her to escape.
But, hey, Otis, what's with your skin, man?
Poison ivy out back, maybe?
We're itchy.
Goddamn, perfect delivery from the Grady twins. Love it. Bill is attacked by Fitzgibbon with a shovel, but totally gets him back for it. He and Kylie get back to the cop car in time to see Starla and MacReady chased by wormbees of their own. Okay, Bill, time for you to drive like you're in a canceled 2007 Fox racing show. He does and hits Deputy Carpenter away from a tied up Mayor MacReady, who should have just taken off his pants to get away. Starla then finishes off Carpenter with a prolonged neck stab, and there's only one thing you can say to that.
Bitch is hardcore.
They escape the wormbees, who mourn the departure with a rendition of Smashing Pumpkins' most masturbatory song. An awkward car ride follows as they process everything that just happened. Bill tries to get Shelby to call the CDC for help. Can you do that, Shelby?
Okay. Shelby, are you nodding?
Sorry. I'll get you right back.
But yep. She won't get him right back, since the Wormies must have also radioed to
send more slugs.
Oh, shit.
In the car, McReady is none too thrilled with the drink selection.
I told your secretary to pack Mr. Pibb. It's the only Coke I like.
And now my shirt makes sense. There's very little merchandise for this film. Kylie then provides some exposition earned from her Slugalingus. She says the worms are a parasitic alien that came from outer space. Referred to in the script as the Long One, this creature goes from planet to planet eating and or absorbing everything in its wake. Kinda like a Galactus skin rash.
It's a conscious disease.
Oh, so you're all fucked. Bill radios back to the office, but Shelby's been replaced with Pam Measley here, who has a little surprise for them. They're hit from the side and knocked out by a fade to black. When they awaken, they're surrounded by Wormbees, and the only way out is more cowbell.
Lore.
I guess it wasn't enough, since Starla and McReady are dragged away while Bill and Kylie escape to the police station. There we see the first of many bodies being dragged away, which I will be counting as dead, whether they currently are or just infected. Spoilers, they'll eventually be dead-dead-dead-ski. Bill heads into the station hoping for communication or gun salvation, but instead he finds my dear friend. This scene was originally supposed to be much bigger, but James Gunn hated the look of this Muppet deer.
Yay!
So Kylie quickly comes in to kill it and mount it on Ash Williams' cabin wall. Taking his ace of spades, Bill equips an incendiary grenade for a little PvP with Grant, hoping that Grant's death will also kill the rest of his brood. He and Kylie make their way towards Grant's house and witness one townsperson getting pukaki, while some more are carried to
Pukaki, really?
In the basement of the Grant house, McReady wakes up surrounded by a cannibal cruise line buffet.
Uh-oh.
Look at those bellies!
Ooh.
Gross. Dimples are for cheeks, not for bellies. McReady agrees, so he runs upstairs and opens the door just in time to get wormalized in the clavicle.
Oh, damn.
Hey, not my kink, but I respect it. He then tries to fight his urges for
meat
until finally succumbing to how delicious these three bodies look. Indulging himself, he goes to town on
damn.
An arm that was made of chewy plastic.
And the blood, of course, is mint flavored, so it was quite a delicious forearm.
Meanwhile, Bill and Kylie are still homeward bound in a bit of a hurry, past more dragged away townsfolk. And then Kylie trips for no reason. Clumsy! Upstairs to the Grant house.
Yo, I like Zuri. I like the popple. We gotta go back. We can't go past that popple. I love it.
Delicious.
Let's go back.
Meanwhile, Bill and Kylie are still homeward bound in a bit of a hurry, past more dragged away townsfolk. And then Kylie trips for no reason. Clumsy! Upstairs at the Grant house, Starla awakens looking like Faye Ray, which is fitting because her King Kong is downstairs playing more air supply. She looks around for a weapon and sees, oh, there is my hairbrush, which she decides to keep for later use. Oh, I wish this dress had pockets. Pocket dresses are the best. She makes her way downstairs past a photo wall of Photoshop memories before revealing what James Gunn called the Cake Monster.
Oh,
no relation to Cookie
Lord.
For Lee. And when he first saw it, he wasn't pleased.
It looked like a bunch of, you know, Beach Boys under a blanket. And I'm like, this is...
It looked like, little like society. I still remember that damn movie, Kill Kayami react to, that I survived.
It was awful, so I shut down set. And then reconstructed for a half a day what that monster looked like, just like with scraps of shit and putting it together.
This epic creature took 7 puppeteers to operate, with extensive rehearsals and testing that started 5 months before production. And while the previous Grant transformation makeups were hard on Michael Rooker, the makeup for this last stage
is actually quite abusive.
Wow.
He was in it for over 18 hours, but never lost his fun spirit, even when he had to shoot it on his 50th birthday.
Oh, man.
I'll be right with you.
It's Rooker's performance in the scene that Gunn remembers most for this film and why he continues to work with him.
He put up with a kind of pain that no other actor, and I believe, seriously, no other actor in Hollywood would ever put up with.
Bill and Kylie finally arrive to see more wheelsy townfolk being dragged away. And I bet yous know what's going on over there. It's shunting time, y'all.
Shunting. Society.
Yes, yeah. Bill sees Starla inside and realizes a man's gotta do what a man's gotta do. So he Derek storms the building, but is briefly thwarted by a Dilophosaurus fanboy that he shoots point blank in the chest. Kylie then takes out a Tommy Jarvis fanboy with a super gooey brain shot. Yep, no maggots in that head anymore. Inside, Starla's doing her best to deal with this extreme home makeover, Cronenberg edition.
You did a real nice job decorating, baby.
She wants her husband to know that she hasn't taken him for granted. It's actually a really nice moment that's played super seriously and gives some depth to our main monster man.
But I feel for the long one, too. I really like the character of, I like the monster.
You know, the Frankenstein monster's in love. He's in love.
And it looks like it works, until she gives him the brush off. She lands a stab before getting Tentacool whipped across the room.
Cool.
Bill and Kylie make it inside to find MacReady looking like a slumber party zit girl. And this monstrous mayor has one request for his constituent.
Kill me, Marty.
Tam shot him like he was an unarmed operative. Classic Mal. He tries to take down the first evil with his grenade, but it doesn't go well.
Shit.
He looks for the grenade and Grant's body George gets screaming mad right as he finds it.
Damn.
Bill looks up to see a whole mess of wormbees before getting attacked by Grant's double hammers.
The hammers are his penises.
He's able to protect his deltoids of compassion, but Grant pumps baby batter right into his abs of being.
Oh, Lord!
The octopus gives Kylie a couchie, which really should have killed her. And yet, no kill graphic.
Nope.
Bill's had enough of these motherfucking tentacles acting like motherfucking wings. So he breaks out the Hank Hill special and fills this former Jacob Toretto caregiver up with propane. It's now up to Starla to take him out. But not before a nice moment of sadness from Rooker that really shows the beauty in this beast. But it doesn't last since Starla goes full governor and fires, blowing out the candles
Fire!
On this cake monster
Tuxie!
And sending it to a Merle grave.
Consider that a divorce.
With Grant Merle, dead, that means all his wormies are dead too. And thanks to the latest in kill counting technology.
Hey mom, bad news. I'm not gonna be able to make it to your birthday. 1, 2, 3, 4.
We're able to say that 97 wheelsy folks became worm food. There's 36 in this wide shot, 14 in front of the house, 2 out of focus bodies here, 23 various bodies in this final wide shot, 5 basement gore gorgers, and 16 over at the Strutmeyer place that all died during Family Fun Day. Oh, and let's not forget Shelby, the serial nodder. Luckily, Bill gets to party on, because
you need both of them things and you to get all wombie.
Oh, that's awesome.
That's right. Everything is awesome. Everything is cool, except your friends are all dead. So you might as well just birdwalk past these pain in the ass to count bodies on your way out of the movie and into the credits. Oh yeah, and there's also a post-credit scene where a pet cat makes a fancy feast out of a Grant chunk that seems very happy about doing a potential sequel.
Look away, Phantom!
How many people lost custody of their lives during Grant and Starla's messy divorce? Let's find out and get to the-
Zoran, you okay?
Yeah! I'm just fine, Sugar Plum. It's just a-
Is that his wife?
Oh. Now you mind handing me a little bit of that doctor there?
No. No!
But I'm so hungry.
This was the interesting one.
127 people died in Slither.
100.
52 men, 37 women, none of them Starla, and 38 unknown, giving us a pie chart made of all kinds of
meat.
With a runtime of 95 minutes, that gives us a kill on average every 0.748 minutes. Starla! I'll give the golden chainsaw for coolest kill to Brenda. James Gunn fought hard to achieve this big boob with a head face vision, and I fought very hard to make her into my worm womb. Bill Machete for lamest kill will go to all the dragged away bodies. They were annoying to keep track of, and you know, if you try dragging a body around, they'll give you more back problems than an 18-hour day in makeup. And that's it.
No, actually, that's it. Slither came out in 2006, and like many horror comedies before it, was a box office bomb. Thankfully, it was well received by critics, so James Gunn was able to work again.
That made my career, because after that, I was worth something as a director, because it got good reviews.
I'll be returning for one more kill count in 2 weeks, with another movie about a small town being invaded by practical effects, Deathgasm. But until then, I'm a man who is currently the-
Well, we'll at least get to see the trailer of it, since before the movie got taken down.
Voice of Blue Bunny Ice Cream, and this has been the Kill Count.
On the next Kill Count.
The ritual has begun. The Zoran will be summoned for one final kill count. But what unholy, blood-soaked abomination will he be covering?
Murder bonus?
Toothed vagina.
Deathgasm.
Cool. What about... I fucking said...
Deathgasm!
A demon-filled heavy metal high school horror comedy epic from New Zealand. Filled with...
Dum-dums vest...
Damn, man. This looks like this looks pretty awesome. I'm so mad I got taken down.
Jumper cables and ammonium nitrate.
No, it's actually filled with brutal heavy metal.
It's piss.
Early Peter levels of blood and gore. Nudity balanced with church stuff.
What part of church are they crying this bad boy, Brody?
And badass catchphrases.
Fuck yeah. Fuck yeah.
So get that dice out of your nose.
It's actually a die. Dice is the plural.
And watch Then on Friday, June 3rd, crank things up to 666 with the kill count. Only on
Maggot Spin.
No, Dead Meat! Come on!
Yes. Good spot for it.
Deathgasm can currently be watched on the pictured streaming platforms. Dead Meat always recommends you watch the movie for yourself before it's...
Alright, well, so...
Here we are. More killer worms, and honestly...
Oh man, that Deathgasm looked pretty awesome. I would love to watch it, but gotta take it down. Hopefully it get revived like Train to Busan did. But other than that, there you go. Slithers was a good pick for y'all to revive, and y'all did a good job reviving it. As well as other kill counts that's been revived as well too, which is Hush, Come to Daddy, and Scariest Tales Stories You Tell in the Dark, but unfortunately Mayhem will remain in the Shadow Realm. Next week, I'll be finishing up the Tremor series, and then with that, I'll officially put up a series poll to see what's next, series, trilogy, whatever you want to call it, franchise, or say, I should, do a reaction to every other week, along with the poll, the original poll as well, too. So other than that, if you like my reaction, like, share, subscribe to my YouTube channel. I think I have some ideas, but I'm about to rethink about it, relook at it, rethink about it and everything. But if your boy, it's your boy T-Bear signing off. The ones I said is Duffy's going to be in is possibly the Predator Order or the Aliens one, because I'm curious of Prometheus. And possibly some short ones as well too, because some I got finished up because I stopped as well too. So other than that, it's your boy T-Bear signing off. One love.